Greetings, friends. Hope everything is going well with you and enjoying the last full month of the summer. I hope you're enjoying your time with your family and friends because you deserve it, all of it. And all the things that you're doing right now, I hope you're tying your health back into your lifestyle, right? If you kind of forgot about it, that's okay. Come back. The fall's here. We're ready to get you back on track again, right? And today we are talking about muscles, those fancy things that make us move and help us lift and basically tell us whether we're strong or weak, right? You know, yeah, we're going to be get you thinking about muscles in a different lens, right? You're going to totally see muscles as a very different thing after this podcast. So we will deep dive into it and hopefully you get some information to help you with your muscles as you age, right? But before we begin, let's discuss what's going on over at Nurse Doza headquarters. We had just launched a nurse practitioner training course. I get to be a mentor for 6 to 10 different nurse practitioners who want to learn how to do exactly what I do. I am a holistic nurse practitioner who does vitamin IVs, lab work, I do PRP injections, I help with supplements, and I really customize healthcare. I feel like what I could teach other nurse practitioners could change the way we look at healthcare in this country. And I'm very honored for this nurse practitioner program to be starting here in the fall. So if you're interested, go to schooldoza.com/MP course and sign up. Thank you. All right, let's get into it. Class is in session. The first thing to know about muscle is that it's an organ. The first thing to know about the muscle or the muscles is that they're an organ. You have a liver, you have a pancreas, you have a heart, you have a brain, right? Well, you have a muscle. The muscle is an organ. You can't just say, oh, I'm going to look at muscles as just the only things I do when I'm exercising, right? I'm using my muscles. No, it's not that. It's not only just when you're walking or sitting. Like, your muscles are an organ that respond to your body and what's going on with your body. It's like, say, stress, okay? If you have stress on the body, you stress the muscles, which are an organ. And I say that they're an organ because guess what? The muscles will ingest and excrete certain things, making them an organ. If you look at muscles, they're broken down to 3 categories. There's something called skeletal muscles, there's something called smooth muscles, and there's something called cardiac muscles. We're talking about your heart. We're talking about your blood circulation, right? We can talk about how exercise is tied into cardiac health. We'll save that for the end, but I want you to understand this. When your muscles are engaged, it makes things called myokines. Myokines are essentially like these derivatives of cytokines and peptides that get released from muscles. And these are very important. And I have to say this, that because when you think about like a bicep, right? Let's say you exercise, you do a curl. When you engage the activation of this muscle, you are making myokines. If you run for a long period of time, you're a long distance runner, you will activate the release of myokines from your hamstrings and your thighs after, 30, 40 minutes. What's incredible about these myokines is that they're both pro-inflammatory and inflammatory or anti-inflammatory at the same time. There's something called brain-derived nootropic factor. And what's incredible about the brain-derived nootropic factor is that brain-derived nootropic factor is essentially a peptide or myokine that comes from your skeletal muscle. Now, what's interesting about this is that I can show you a research article that shows Alzheimer's patients have low amounts of brain-derived nootropic factor. And I can show you another article that says exercise increases brain-derived nootropic factors. Exercise increases the release of brain-derived nootropic factors from your skeletal muscles, increasing your cognition and lessening your risk of cognitive decline. Exercise has been one of the most incredible tools for the human body. Exercise can make you healthy, but exercise can actually make you sick at the same time. Let's talk about another thing that's released from the muscles. There's something called NT-proBNP, and I have to talk about this real quickly because this is a lab test that I've ordered many times. So your heart is essentially a muscle, right? The heart itself is kind of an organ slash muscle, which is really weird because the heart is an engine on a circulation, right? Like it's a pump. The heart is a pump, right? And blood circulates through it, and the heart pumps blood through the rest of the body. That's what the main job of the heart is to do. And when the heart is a muscle and it overworks itself, there's this term called hypertrophy, cardiac hypertrophy, right? And the heart is broken up into four components. There's ventricles and atriums. And the atrials that are up there, they're on the top, the ventricles on the bottom. The left ventricle, like if I'm looking forward, bottom left, left ventricle is the main muscle group that pushes out the blood out of the heart. And this has to be a very strong muscle because the heart itself is a muscle and it needs to pump blood to your entire body. Like when you think about blood pressure, your blood opens up and all the blood circulates and fills into the heart. And then when your heart squeezes, the lub dub, right? Then it squeezes out and it pushes out all the blood to like your arms, your legs, your liver, like your, you know, everywhere. Well, the left ventricle is doing that. It's ejecting. And so if you measure this other test called the ejection fraction, right? Like you're looking at the ability to eject blood out of the heart into circulation. Well, this NT-proBNP test, it measures this peptide that comes out of the muscles too. It comes out of the cardiac muscle. And if you have a lot of damage to your heart, like let's say you've overworked it, like I imagine a long distance runner, a CrossFitter, I would imagine the person that has basically worked out every single day for the last 20 years and doesn't know how to stop working out. The guy who can't stop going to the gym. The lady who can't stop running. The person who can't stop cycling. The gymnast who turned into a long distance runner, who turned into the idea that they're a workaholic. Like, it's all there. If your heart works too hard, you have high blood pressure and a high heart rate, and you can be at risk for atrial fibrillation. The muscles directly go back into the idea that they respond to whatever stress you're putting on the body. If I measure this NT-proBNP, I've seen it high in people, and I'm like, man, you're stressing your heart out. Why are you working so hard? Oh, I don't know. I'm just, you know, I like to work out. I'm like, yeah, but your muscles can't take that. There's exercise and there's over-exercising. This proBNP is a prime example of it. I've ordered this in endurance athletes. I've always worked with athletes. Athletes are a different breed. I love working with athletes because they listen. They're really open and they're really knowledgeable. So when we order labs on athletes, I order labs like right after a race. The proBNP was really high after a race on someone. And I was like, you're stressing your heart out too much when you run. Like, that's not good. Your heart, you know, shouldn't be pumping that much blood out if it's being overworked. So once again, I bring that up because for all the athletes that are listening out there, you can't overdo it. I love exercise. It's a tool. You know, sunlight's a tool. Sunlight gives us energy, right? It goes into our skin that is right above our muscles, right? But once again, like you can overburn your skin, right? If you're in the sun too long. You can overexercise and make your heart work too hard, and then the muscle gets too big, and next thing you know, you have heart attacks. So yes, you have to understand the muscle is an organ, and you have to delicately take care of it. On a side note, there's one more thing I want you to understand. When I said smooth muscle, that second thing, I'm talking about cardiac arteries. Let me go back to arteries now. So your arteries are a muscle as well. And I've been thinking about this for a while. I think the arteries are like an organ as well. I think you can have insulin resistance of your arteries, and that's what happens with stroke, and that's what happens with vascular dementia. So there's something called the nitric oxide synthase pathway. And I'm gonna get a little geeky now, so just stay with me. So like I said, your muscles are an organ, and there's something called your arteries, right? Which is basically your blood circulation. Well, your arteries have this system in there called the NOS system. And the NOS system, the nitric oxide synthase system, is there to help you with something called circulation. It opens up the arteries for better circulation, like vasodilation. If you have arteries that constrict, it's called vasoconstriction. Well, your arteries will basically respond to stress and will help your arteries constrict or open up. That's what stress does, right? That's literally what your nerves do because they innervate your arteries and they do that, right? So you have increased blood pressure when you vasoconstrict and you're just stressed out, right? White knuckling it, your blood pressure goes up, right? I can measure your NT-proBNP, it goes up like you're stressing your heart out. Well, the other thing is if you have a healthy blood flow, you have healthy nitric oxide. And what happens with that is that you can have elasticity in your arteries. They open up and they close, dilate, constrict very easily. That's healthy circulation. And I point this out because this has to happen throughout the body. This isn't just happening in the heart. Let's go back to the brain again. All right. They talk about the brain being a muscle. The brain has many muscles within it and has many organs within the brain. So the brain is an organ within a body that basically uses the brain to control all the reactions to stress and your environment, right? So what happens with circulation? Blood circulation is just the carrying of nutrients throughout the body. That's all blood is. Blood has like vitamins in it, amino acids, which we're gonna get into in a second. There's insulin in it. Like I can measure testosterone in the blood. I can measure that brain-derived nootropic factor, the NT-proBNP. Well, what's incredible about going back to the arteries is the arteries are just tunnels, they're pipes. If you destroy your circulation, I'm worried about your brain. They have showed that this NOS pathway, when it's disrupted, it causes dementia, vascular dementia of the brain. If you exercise, you have better circulation in your arteries. Exercise activates the NOS system. Exercise is a tool. It literally helps your arteries stay healthier and stay elastic. That way it can help you with circulation. Exercise causes your muscles now to increase something called brain-derived nootropic factor that stimulates brain cognition, right? Here's another thing you didn't know about muscles. Your muscles can also be a fatty muscle. When you think about your muscles, no one thinks about it like an organ. And I'm telling you, like every single part of your body is like an organ. It releases things, it takes things in. Your muscles take in sugar, okay? There's insulin receptors on your muscles. And if you are an athlete and you have high amounts of blood sugar, you burn off all that floating glucose through your bloodstream and it goes into your muscles when you exercise, because when you exercise, you activate the ability to absorb floating glucose for energy. That's what skeletal muscles do, okay? If you're a long distance runner, you're going to use a lot of glucose for energy and burn it off using your muscles. But let's say that you're not a long distance runner, and let's say you're very lackadaisical term to say that you're sedentary. You don't get off the couch much. You don't go to the gym. You don't work out. You don't even walk. You work from home. You don't do anything, right? Like let's say that that's the case. Your muscles can get fat. What will happen is the insulin will take, it's like an Uber driver. Insulin takes in all the burgers, the fries, the shakes, the sodas, the pizza, the tamales, like whatever did you ever consume. And the insulin, the Uber driver, takes the tamales, the cookies, and it stores in the liver, and then it stores it in your fat cells, and when there's no more room, it then stores it in your muscles. If you don't engage your skeletal muscles for exercise, and you have a sedentary lifestyle, you don't use that sugar for anything, your body's still gonna stuff sugar in there. Does that make sense? Like if you use the sugar for energy purposes, it's because you're exercising. If you don't exercise, you just keep stuffing sugar into your muscles and then eventually they turn to fat deposits. And then your muscles literally have fat deposits in them. You've heard of a fatty liver? You could have a fatty bicep. You could have a fatty hamstring. Seriously, you could have a fatty abdomen. You definitely believe me on that one now, because go look at everyone's waist circumference in America right now and don't tell me that they don't have fat in those muscles on their abs. not only can you have fat accumulate on the outside of like your muscles, you can accumulate in the inside of the muscles and behind the muscles on top of the organs. Not on top of that, you could get the fat accumulating inside the organs as well. The skin is an organ, okay? Your arteries are an organ. Your gut is an organ. Your bones are an organ. Do we not get the hint? When we talk about nutrients, this gets me to my next point. The next thing you need to know about muscles is that they love amino acids, specifically glutamine. So amino acids are a form of protein. When we talk about protein, we're talking about macronutrients. A long time ago when I learned nutrition, I learned carbohydrates, proteins, and fats were part of what's called our macronutrients. And someone a long time ago decided that the body was designed for 65% carbohydrates as the main source of its energy when it comes to macronutrients. And so the last 100 years in the United States, we've been taught that the human body runs off of carbohydrates for its energy, and it should. It was a lie. It was a complete lie, I think made up by some other forces that we probably don't even know about. Cereal was invented to give us another excuse for empty calories. And what's fascinating about those empty calories is that there was no nutrients in cereal. You imagine that Wheaties, for example, has the Olympic star, gold medalist on the cover of a Wheaties box telling kids, this is how you start your day. If you want to go to the Olympics and win a gold medal too, you are gonna do what I do and eat a bowl full of GMO processed crap that's gonna inflame your gut, and you're gonna wash it down with a bowl full of processed dairy that's gonna cause you to have sinus issues and hormone disruption your entire life. It's the breakfast of champions. And if you think about that, all of that is what we were taught, including myself as an athlete. And you say, well, that's supposed to fuel the muscles, right? Carbs, right? Carbs, carbs, carbs. Cyclists were taught 10,000 calories before my race is ideal, because that's how much calories and carbohydrates I'm going to burn up in the body, because glucose is the main source of gasoline in the body. And if you talk to every biochemist in the country, in the world, they will agree on that statement. In fact, you go look up in the studies right now, they say the gut, the main source of the gut, the main source of energy is glucose. And then if you go look up the brain, they're going to say the main source of energy for the brain is glucose. That has been an old ideology that has been taught for us and to us for the last, stuffed down our throats for the last 100 years. And it was a lie. It was the half-truth. The brain does fine without glucose. There's something called ketosis, ketones. And what's fascinating now is going back to the brain. I talked about the brain-derived nootropic factor, skeletal muscle. If you think about ketones, ketones comes from your liver. You have to look at your body as a car. If your body's a car and you go fill up at the gas station with gasoline, you have three choices representing your macronutrients, your carbs, your proteins, your fats. So let's say I am a high functioning individual, a high functioning car, a vintage car. I am not going to put that crappy unleaded carbohydrate gasoline in this beautiful vintage car. No way. This vintage 1982 deserves better than that. I'm thinking the high premium octane burning fat. That's what the macronutrient high premium gasoline is. It's a fat. When they gave ketones to people with dementia, they produce more brain-derived nootropic factors. They increased their cognition, their brain capability. Their brains got better. They looked at their MRIs, they got better. With fat, not glucose, fat. Because the last thing you want to give to a person with dementia is more glucose. Because guess what? Alzheimer's and dementia nowadays, vascular dementia, type 3 diabetes, insulin resistance of the brain, insulin resistance of your arteries. I'm telling you, you have to look at your arteries as an organ. You have to look at your brain having an organ within it. It has a system of an organ basically called your arteries. And your arteries are an organ that can basically switch on and off with sugar, with inflammation and stress, lack of sleep, lack of sunlight. That's how the arteries circulate. It's sunlight. It's stress. How do you think blood circulates through your body, right? But what happens when we eat crap, when we eat fast food, that also circulates through our blood. And if it winds up in the brain, because remember, the brain loves glucose, right? If you're eating fast food, then your brain is eating fast food too. and it's all going through the pipes and the arteries in your brain, shutting down the NOS system, causing vascular dementia to start in the arteries. And remember, the brain's made of fat. It's not made of sugar. The brain's made of omega-3 DHA. That's why I'm always promoting fish oil and salmon and sardines, because my brain's made of omega-3. Why would I want to promote the healthy supply of carbohydrates to the brain? And if anything, we've been taught that ketones and fat, healthy olive oil, healthy avocado, lessens insulin resistance of the brain, thus improving vascular dementia, cognition, and even longevity. To this day, the Mediterranean diet is still one of the number one diets promoted throughout the American Heart Association, the American Diabetes Association, and they promote fat. Because remember, 40, 50 years ago, they said fat was bad for you, it's going to cause a stroke. Complete BS. They even said chicken eggs were going to cause a stroke. Complete BS. The thing that's always going to cause a stroke and will to this day is processed sugar. And processed sugar comes in the form of processed bread, processed rice, processed corn, processed chocolate, processed dairy. There's sugar in dairy. Trust me, there's sugar in dairy. That's why you love your milk so much. That's why you put in your Starbucks, because there's sugar in it. Because we were taught our whole lives that sugar is what we need, that our body runs off of sugar. Complete false. I just got done doing a 3-day fast, and I'm gonna look at my labs, and I've done this before. My glucose goes down to like 50. I did a 6-day fast before. My glucose went down to 56. From 93 to 56, my cholesterol went through the roof. I was in ketosis. And when I'm running in ketosis, my brain is sharp. On this 3rd day fast that I just completed, I didn't want to break it. I felt incredible. But guess what I broke it with? Glutamine. Because I understood this. L-glutamine is an amino acid. L-glutamine is the most abundant amino acid we have in our body. If you look at the lungs, you look at the gut, you look at the kidneys, they all have high amounts of glutamine. Glutamine is still one of the top supplements for bodybuilders in the world. I just got talking to Baldo about a video. I saw this huge jacked up bodybuilder. He consumes tons of glutamine right after each workout. And I go and I look in at this and I say, this guy's on to something. Obviously, this is years ago. But here's the thing, what I use glutamine for. I use it for the gut. The gut is lined with L-glutamine. And when you have leaky gut, you have a disruption in that line of L-glutamine in your digestive tract. Because in our gut powder, which is solely L-glutamine, when we give L-glutamine as a recommendation to people and they use our gut powder by MSW Nutrition, or L-glutamine from anywhere, I don't care, it's just L-glutamine, it goes into the lining of the gut and it kind of patches up the leaky gut. And it helps kind of patch up the inflammation and allows your gut to heal and repair. Because L-glutamine is what the gut's made out of. It's part of it. When you take L-glutamine, they have shown with athletes, if you go on a long distance workout, you're gonna produce high amounts of ammonia, okay, in your body. That's just a natural byproduct of that. You're also gonna have a decrease in glutamine. Coincidentally, high amounts of ammonia is really bad for your body. You need to get rid of that. Glutamine's the way to do it. They have found that if you supplement with glutamine after a workout, you lessen the amount of ammonia buildup in your body. I think that's one of the reasons why bodybuilders love it, but it also, amino acids synthesize all your muscles. Your muscles need protein, yes, but what you really need are amino acids. Branch chain amino acids like leucine have always been given to help with muscle growth. There's something called mTOR. mTOR is a gene that is found in skeletal muscle. What's interesting about it is it's activated with the help of things like leucine, a branch chain amino acid. Amino acids activate and regulate mTOR, this vital gene that helps you with protein synthesis in the muscles, helping you grow muscles. This is why amino acids have always been popular with bodybuilders, because things like glutamine and things like branch chain amino acids help you gain muscle and build muscle mass. And if you take these into your diet and you basically supplement right after a workout, the theory is you will get bigger muscles. Hence why you eat protein before and after your workouts. And for bodybuilders who are showing, they do the carb load, right? Because all of that is going to go into the muscles. Remember, you can get a fatty muscle if you don't work out. But if you work out, not only do you get the glucose going into the muscle, but you get the proteins, okay? And what you really want is not just the proteins, you want the amino acids, like carnitine, glutamine, arginine, citrulline, all of those things help with muscle growth. So when you're looking at a scoop of amino acids, I literally take a scoop of amino acids with my boost in the morning. There's carnitine in there, there's taurine in there, there's arginine in there. And then I put my scoop of L-glutamine or gut powder in there, but now I'm just doing the gut powder by itself. When I broke my fast, I did 4 scoops of L-glutamine powder or gut powder with just water. I had energy. I think L-glutamine converts into energy production in the body. I think that's what it does. I think it's a substitute, a great substitute for energy in your gut. I think, honestly, I'm gonna go on a bold statement here and say, glutamine is the preferred energy for the gut. Because guess what? When it comes to gut issues, you could have something called small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. And that's a disruption of your bacteria and your digestive tract. And it's because you have insulin resistance of your digestive tract. And that's what leads me to my next section. The next thing you need to know about your muscles is that it's regulated by insulin. Everything's regulated by insulin. I just got done doing a podcast about PCOS, and I said the first thing in PCOS, it's a problem with insulin. If you have a problem with your muscles, whether they're small or big, fatty or not, you have a problem with your insulin. Because insulin's gonna, remember, the Uber driver, it's gonna store the proteins, it's gonna store the glucose in your muscles. And if your insulin's really high, it's because you're having to stuff a bunch of stuff in your muscles. Hopefully you're working out, because then you can utilize that for muscle growth. If you don't work out, you have no muscle growth. And remember, I'm not wanting you to get big muscles. You don't have to exercise and do weightlifting in order to get big muscles. No, no, no. I promote weightlifting to diabetics. And the American Heart Association and the American Diabetes Association will back me up on this. They're going to say, yeah, we've seen that weight resistance improves insulin sensitivity. I was like, yeah, it makes sense. When you engage in stimulation of exercise, you lower insulin resistance of your muscles, making you have less of a fatty muscle, because now you're utilizing all that stored energy that you're putting in your biceps and your triceps and your butt muscles, right? See, that makes sense? How many people have insulin resistance? If you have insulin resistance, you're basically gonna shift the formation of protein synthesis in muscles and build muscles, and you're gonna build fat in muscles instead. That's what happens with insulin resistance of the muscles. And then those muscles don't get to make brain-derived nootropic factor that helps protect you against things like dementia, right? And all you have to do is exercise. You have to lift a little bit of weights. Do a little bit of leg press, you know, a lunge here and there if you can handle it. Yeah, I'm a big fan of yoga. If you do some yoga chairs, I'm telling you right now, you do some yoga chairs, you'll start building those thigh muscles that everyone is basically atrophying. Because you sit down all day, I can tell you which muscles you need to engage right now. All right, because I'm a chiropractor, I can't send you home without a muscle exercise. You need to basically, when you're sitting down, take like a pillow or something kind of semi-soft, right? And put it in between your knees while you're sitting down. And you need to squeeze that pillow or that ball with your inner thigh muscles. You know why? Because those are called your vastus medialis and your adductors. And most people, because they sit all day, don't engage this muscle group. When you squeeze, like remember Suzanne Summers back in the day, the thigh master? If you engage those muscles, you're stronger and your core is stronger. You can walk stronger. You can run stronger. Your knees won't be in pain. Yeah, and those muscles, if those muscles are weak, look at this. I'll make the case right now, because you know that muscles release something called myokines, like brain-derived nootropic factors that save your brain. Imagine you sitting down all day is causing your muscles to help you not support your brain, and you're getting one step closer to Alzheimer's. That's why every 65 seconds someone in this country is diagnosed with dementia. It's because we sit all day. I mean, I'm sitting right now, but I worked out before this and I engaged these muscles, so it a little bit goes a long way. It doesn't take much. I'm not sitting here telling you, pun intended, you need to go work out for an hour in the gym. Go work out for 15, 20 minutes. Get a sweat. That's it. Get a sweat. Get some oxygen. Get the blood flowing. Increase the NOS. Increase the BDNFs, right? Lower the insulin resistance of the muscles. I mean, if you want a supplement to basically not only help your gut, but maybe build a little muscle, our gut powder, the glutamine. The L-glutamine, it's a whole nother thing that I'm thinking of, right? Because look, the last thing I want you to think about, when you're exercising and when you're engaging your muscles, when you're moving, you're promoting the fight against dementia, okay? exercise deficiency, lack of exercise, lack of activity will cause your brain to have dementia. That's not anything new. You have to exercise. This is not a 30-day challenge. This is not like I'm gonna do 75 hard. I plan on working out until the day I die. And whatever life form I go into next, I am definitely working out there. Baldo climbs mountains. I mean, he wants to climb every summit around the world, and he's not gonna stop until he does it. That's cool. And it's cool because it's a challenge, but it's also something different than just go running a marathon. I'm not gonna kill my knees to go do that, and I've seen too many people injure themselves. Plus, I don't think it's all that healthy for you, because honestly, like I said, unless you're taking the glutamine right after you do your run, you're basically causing all kinds of problems with your ammonia and insulin and all that, your glucose, right? So exercise is more than just looking good and having vanity muscles. And I'm telling this to myself as well. Exercise saves your brain. Exercise protects your muscles. Exercise protects your heart. Exercise protects your blood pressure, your heart rate, your longevity, your sleep. Protects your gut, right? Protects your insulin. If you want to try an exercise, go to a yoga studio. Take a yoga class online. Try it 3 times a week. And I would say, if I could get you to do 20, 30 minutes of movement, don't call it exercise, call it movement. Walking is great, but I need you to kind of engage your muscles a little bit more. Like if you're walking and you decide to do some lunges, like while you're walking, that's great. If you do some body squats while you're doing it, jumping jacks for crying out loud. I mean, something, right? Like walking is great, but you need to resist some kind of weight in order to build up the insulin sensitivity of your muscles in order to improve your brain health. So go out and get a dumbbell, go get a kettlebell. One of my good friends used to tell me a 30-pound kettlebell goes a long way. In conclusion, hopefully this podcast taught you a little bit, a couple of things differently about muscles. I know it did me because I'm a chiropractor who was trained in sports chiropractic, and I've treated athletes my whole life. I'm an athlete. We do not understand the human body and nutrition and metabolism the way that we were taught in school. I made that very apparent. Today's podcast was an accumulation of all the multidisciplinary approaches that I have found in healthcare, and not one of them has it right. I'm going to be honest too. Chiropractic is not the only one that has it right. There is tons of different necessities when it comes to healthcare, but when you think about a chiropractor, a physical therapist, when you think about a cardiologist, when you think about a neurologist, by the time you see them, there's something already going on with you, right? Because it's rare that you go to the chiropractor when you don't have pain. It's rare that you go to a neurologist when you don't have a headache. And it's rare that you decide to do something about your heart until you wake up one day and you're grabbing your chest and you're like, okay, I got to do something about it now because my Apple Watch is telling me something's wrong. When you think about what you're able to do, you take a podcast like this, you take the information, and you make a behavior change. That's all I want you to do. If any of this motivated you to go exercise, just understand I'm doing the same thing that you are, and I'm telling every single person that comes in my clinic, exercise and move because your life depends on it. If you want a great supplement to include for your muscles, take our gut powder by MSW Nutrition. Use Nurse Doza as a code, and hopefully I will see you in our class. If you're a nurse practitioner, hopefully I will see you in the mentor program. Until next time, class is concluded. Keep working on your health.